and faith have always been the focus of the Turner War Lectureship. Brandon has lived and expressed his faith in many ways, including as an intern at the Quaker Peace Center in Cape Town, South Africa, as a missionary in Nairobi, Kenya, serving ecumenical organizations, through a position in Toronto, Canada, where he worked with students interested in faith-based social activism, and as Associate Director of Compassion, the Relief, Refugee, and Development Ministry of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ. And he continues to live out his faith as Senior Minister of First Christian Church in Chattanooga, Tennessee. The story of Brandon's life is one of community building, peace and social justice work, and the intersection of culture and faith. We welcome him today to help us explore what it might mean to be a citizen, a change maker, and an advocate for peace and justice in a new, uncertain time. Welcome, Brandon. We're very thankful that you're here with us.
So I'm honored and intimidated to be here. So for the opportunity to feel both of those things, I'm thankful to the planning committee that asked me to come. I'm not, by temperament or by training, a scholar, but I've instead long entertained my call to ministry as one where the work of interpretation and practice intersect. Writing has always been for me not only about ideas, not only about texts, but about life itself. Reason and rationality, sure, but also the realism that grits its teeth when theories and formulas stop making sense. Stories matter to me. People's real lives matter to me. And the hope that is beyond words, the hope expressed in the Christian faith, matters to me. I'm grateful for an invitation to spend some time exploring not only ideas, not only texts, but perhaps the real life that we share together, even if it's just for a few minutes with you this afternoon. It also does not escape me that Lynchburg, Virginia is itself an interesting place for us to have this conversation. This congregation has long shared a progressive vision and ministry in a place where the ghost of Jerry Falwell Sr. looms large, even before he was a ghost. And of course, this is also a community where both poetry and biblical studies were smashed with the introduction of the phrase 2 Corinthians just a few months ago. Christian fundamentalism has long woven itself into the landscape. But as faithful, progressive Christians like First Christian Church and institutions of higher learning committed to the education of a diverse student body like Lynchburg College prove, the landscape can look a lot different from a different perspective. There's not simply one way to understand that landscape, not one way to understand the world, and there's not simply one way to understand the Christian faith or any other religious tradition. And there is certainly not only one way to understand the Holy One we call God. But in an attempt to understand the current climate in which we find ourselves, as people of many and no faith, as political people, and as people who are concerned about the world in which we live, I want to begin this from a number of vantage points, some clearly my own, and a couple because they are wrapped up in the practice of poetic language and fiction making, are perhaps my own, but perhaps something entirely different. And so I begin with a different voice. The voice I seem to bring to life now, I hope, is a fitting one, given the love of literature and theology that embodies the legacies of John Turner and Pete Warren. Introduction to Theodicy. She believed that evil was ultimately something banal. She liked to tell her students that she learned about original sin sharing a refrigerator with two roommates. The darkest cruelty she ever experienced was brushed off by a high school principal who would drink himself to death years later. Boys will be boys, he shrugged. You'll survive. Boys will be boys. Dogs will eat their own shit. It's how things are. People who had never in their life put a child in an oven or sick a dog on one or dropped a bomb will, at the same time, never lift a finger until it affects their property's value. There's nothing superficial or supernatural about evil. It is what we do. It's like trying to wrestle a Rubik's Cube, she liked to tell her students. Don't try so hard. All this talk of God and why? We love to say that we are the builders and the discoverers and the makers. We forget that we are also the ones who pluck, the ones who break, and the ones who cover it all up. Still, there were nights when the old puzzle with which she always opened her first 8:50 a.m. lecture of the spring semester. If God is good, then God is not God. And if God is God, then God is not good. Kept her up all hours. She turned it on all of its sides, tried to make the pieces fit, the colors match. They never did. Perhaps it is not what puzzles do, she'd muse, twisting her wrist one more time, on a hunch, and something like a prayer. Just a few weeks ago, in an essay entitled Breaking Faith, a contributing editor at The Atlantic magazine, Peter Beinart, named an assumption that I have been struggling with for the last several years. As you might well know from research around American Christianity, we have learned that there is a growing percentage of people who claim no religious faith, people known as the nuns, for shorthand. These are folks who see American culture, civil society, and life in purely secular terms. 22% of Americans claimed no religious tradition in 2014, up from 6% in 1992. And in the essay, Beinart considered how, this is his quote, some observers predicted that this new secularism would ease cultural conflict as the country settled into a near consensus on issues such as gay marriage and others. After Barack Obama took office, a Center for American Progress report declared that the demographic change led by secular, tolerant young people was undermining the long-standing cultural wars. And in 2015, the conservative writer David Brooks, noting Americans' growing detachment from religious institutions, urged social conservatives to put aside the culture war that has alienated large parts of three generations. As a Generation X Christian minister, someone whose faith is shared by many friends, and who also counts friends who see my faith as a bit of a foreign curiosity, I have to say that I shared the assumption that Beinart described. A more secular America sounded to me like a more religiously neutral America, where there was more room for religious diversity. To my ear, this all sounded like a more tolerant America. In the wake of the 2016 election, a political drama that was marked by accusations of serious journalism being fake news, of incredibly violent rhetoric, and of the re-mainstreaming of xenophobia, the idea of a more tolerant America, Beinart argues, was naive. Instead, what Beinart describes is a political discourse that is not rooted in a tolerant neutrality or the long-gone shared assumption of culturally Christian values. Neither one exists anymore. But instead, the political discourse reflects an increasingly brutal partisanship. The boundaries between who is an us and who is a them are not only firm, they are spiked, sharp enough to draw blood. And while Beinart notes that these divisions have emerged across the political spectrum, what concerns me most are two emerging elements that I would call the new part of the new nationalism: secular evangelicals and the alt-right. Of the many surprises of the 2016 election, one was that was most puzzling to many observers was the support for Donald Trump, the thrice-married playboy known for gambling, swindling, and womanizing among evangelicals. The reason, as Beinart cites, looking at research done by Notre Dame political scientist Jeffrey Lehman, Trump does best among evangelicals with one key trait. None of them really go to church. There were plenty of committed church-going evangelicals who voted for Trump out of resignation, seeing him as the lesser of two evils because they objected to Hillary Clinton's support of abortion rights or saw her as having integrity issues around scandals connected to her name. But in a close election that played the razor-thin margins of electoral politics, Trump was able to capture the political support of people who identified as evangelicals but do not attend churches. Perhaps, Beinart argues, because he was able to name their despair, rooted in a nostalgic desire for identity and economic security, and also name their resentments, which are rooted in economic concerns, Latino and Hispanic immigrants, fear, Muslims, and historic divides, African Americans. If Lehman's thesis and number crunching is correct, what seems to be emerging is a Christian identity that is not shaped by the lived out experience of Christian community. Community that, though sometimes exclusively, sometimes superficially, emphasizes forgiveness and love of neighbor. This new emerging Christian identity, presented almost as a closely guarded, always threatened possession, easily cross-pollinates with xenophobia and uncritical patriotism to the degree that these elements become indistinguishable from one another. It's a frightening prospect, different from the religious right of Falwell Sr.'s generation, which looks almost genteel in comparison. It is no longer about a national sense of morality or doctrinal correctness, but about the possession of the power that comes with being the right tribe, and thus endowed with the freedom to set boundaries and make rules. It's the way, the truth, and the life, but without the baggage or commitment of love your neighbor as yourself. Beinart also describes the white supremacist movement that has become known as the alt-right as a closely related, though even more secular, phenomenon. Though the alt-right seems to be a gathering of ideological strands that are not easily articulated into a coherent theology or philosophy, it does seem to be emerging as secular, ideologically weaponized white nationalism, a successor of the religious right that uses racialized, nostalgic language as a touchstone and rallying cry. Though it's still fringe, the rising prominence of Breitbart Media, which has served as a self-proclaimed platform for the alt-right, and other media outlets has allowed alt-right activists to gather a bit of credibility among disaffected whites. As is the case in a number of nationalist movements across Europe, the alt-right movement has leveraged resentment and identity into the work of bringing a fantasy to life. There is the West, which represents enlightened culture, and then there are the barbarians. American liberalism and open-mindedness has made us weak. We need to reclaim our identity and guard it mightily. As Beinart sums up the alt-right, its leaders, like Christendom, an old-fashioned word for the West, but they're suspicious of Christianity itself because it crosses boundaries of blood and soil. These two phenomena share an uncertainty and need for identity that folks seem to be yearning for. And it's easy to see that in a multicultural, more secular, more consumer-minded America, to which you're marketed based on aesthetic, political, and other preferences, it might be easy to get lost. The former editor of Breitbart News, now serving as chief strategist to President Trump, Steve Bannon, is often mentioned in the same breath as the term alt-right. Though he doesn't necessarily describe his own political views in such a way, he's still looked at as an organizer and leader of the movement. In a televideo presentation at a 2014 conference on poverty hosted at the Vatican by the Human Dignity Institute, a conservative group with Catholic roots, you had Bannon talking about some of his ideas. And while I think it's harder to nail down Bannon on white supremacy, what emerges here in his remarks is a clear mythic though I wouldn't say uncommon, fusion of the West and Christianity, and a clear sense of Christian supremacy. Here Bannon says, "We're at the very beginning stages of a very brutal and bloody conflict, of which the people in this room, all Catholic, the people in this church, do not bind together and really form what I feel is an aspect of the church militant, to really be able to not just stand with our beliefs, but to fight for our beliefs against this new barbarity that's starting, that will completely eradicate everything that we've been bequeathed over the last 2,000 or 2,500 years. This new barbarity, in case you couldn't tell from the context, is Islam." Bannon seems to be picking up on Samuel Huntington's Clash of Civilizations thesis, that humanity can be classified into a small handful of civilizations, Western and Islamic, for example, and that these would be the prime reason for conflict in the post-Cold War era. Though Huntington's thesis has come under fire from folks who say that he painted the world with far too broad a brush, or trafficked in stereotypes, Huntington's Clash of Civilizations was analysis. For Bannon, it's a rallying cry. His response, which it should not escape us, the context in which this happened was in a conference on global poverty. His response is a call for the church militant, a phrase that is both nostalgic and reflective of the brutality of political discourse that Bannon has described. It is Christian faith in the service of a nationalist, or let us say, civilizationist hegemony. The fact that these points of view are finding wider acceptance should give us pause. But when we consider what this means, we should also realize that this is not about one person, one theorist, one presidential candidate, one election. As Bannon reminds us, it's about all of us and the type of discourse, politics, and culture we are creating. Our self-definitions, our boundaries, our identities themselves are now weapons. Though I've described the phenomenon of the new nationalism and secular evangelical piety in stark, dramatic, and maybe even hyperbolic terms, it's ultimately not to hold up a straw man, but a mirror. After all, are we, in our need to be correct, our desire to be the ones who name and control truth, hope, and justice, do we not design our own tribal need for community? Are we that different? And is it a difference of kind, of type, or simply degree? I return to that fictional theologian whose questions about God and evil keep her from sleeping. Evil is not so much supernatural as it is natural. We like to hold up the Bonhoeffers, the Martin Luther Kings, the Dorothy Days, the anti-war, justice-seeking saints. We like to hold them up as who we are. But as this nameless theologian reminds us in the middle of the night, as the Christian tradition reminds us, we are also the ones who enforce laws, just or unjust. We're also the ones who ignore the reports of drone warfare. We're the ones who raise the rents in our neighborhoods. And we're the ones who ask if we get to throw the first stone. And as we lionize these role models, we claim that it is through memory, through remembering the mistakes, the resistance, and the lessons of the past that we will never again make the same mistakes. We will remember how to do things better. But perhaps it's actually the smoke and fogs of memory that keep us in destructive patterns. He remembers the day when his daily 2-mile run suddenly became more difficult. But he does not remember how it became customary to come together every week to bury so many dead. Shoulder a harsh winter, that's something he can still do. Though he can no longer shovel the snow at the same pace, though his hearing has begun to fail him faster than his memory, thanks be to the one who gave that gift in the first place. But there are days, he declares in the dark to the silent congregation, he still sees before he falls into an unsteady sleep. There are days when he takes out his hearing aid and shouts when he only means to whisper. There are days when he would rather lose his memory, or at least put cognition to bed. He remembers the day the copy of the Atlantic Monthly with "The Negro Is Your Brother" arrived in his mailbox. He had grown tired of the sleepy work of his tiny town's parish, but he felt his heart skip and a buzz behind his brain when he read, "I am in Birmingham because injustice is here." And it carried him for the next 30 years as he sipped tea, baptized, broke bread, and sat beside so many deathbeds. "Surely we will see the day," was the hope that sustained him. But he feels the buzz ring differently today when his granddaughter, the one with the purple hair, the one loud enough for him to hear always, tells him something about hashtags and dash cams and a woman in Texas dead in a jail cell named Sandra. She tells him about dead bodies and wounds self-inflicted. "Surely, surely," she was yelling, and not for his benefit, "there is justice. Surely, surely, the truth will set us all free. Surely, it will." In the night, he remembers the day he first noticed his hearing lose a step, how he misunderstood names and repeated them wrong. No one corrected him. No one wanted to embarrass him. It was at a funeral for a stranger, and he named the wrong dead soul. He remembers aloud that night, soldiers and sailors and travelers and young women locked away on their last nights. Men gunned down with babies on the way, men gunned down lest they kill some more. He remembers the dead, mourns them as his own, is sure to say their names, and he prays that his sobs might at last be loud enough to wake them. This past week, President Trump signed an executive order that launched the beginning of the end of the 2015 Clean Power Plan, an Obama-era policy which aimed to cut emissions from existing coal and gas-fired power plants. In doing so, he said the following: "Perhaps no single regulation threatens our miners, energy workers, and companies more than this crushing attack on American industry. While it is true that coal mining jobs are in decline, the majority of fact-checkers, industry and energy analysts, and other informed observers will point to the rise of other cleaner energy sources, technological advances that increase efficiency while utilizing fewer workers, and associated market forces like an oil boom as having more impact than emission standards. Nonetheless, the rhetoric has remained part of our news cycle and our national dialogue." Now, anti-regulation politics are nothing new. I grew up in Kentucky, though I grew up in the tobacco-producing part of the state, not the part where coal is king. Nonetheless, the rhetoric always evokes something quite close to home for me. In the 80s and 90s, as public health advocates clashed with big tobacco around smoking-related health concerns, the protests of farmers, buyers, community leaders with economic and other interests in the tobacco industry gave birth to a defiant fusion of anti-regulation politics and the smoke and mirrors of nostalgia. I remember big bumper stickers that said, "Tobacco paid for this truck." For my part today, I'm not as interested in the questions of economics as I am with the question of nostalgia. As it has been an overriding theme in both the electoral politics of the last election, the post-game analysis of that election, and the ongoing conversation about the state of our nation. Now, nostalgia is never far from the work of nation building. We rely on myths that bolster up our self-understanding, myths of cherry trees, of shots heard around the world, of a more perfect union. We use them to articulate and continue to shape who we say we are. And it's easy to let those foundational myths transform into an idealized past that we long for. Since November 2016, we've known that nostalgia can become a winning strategy in electoral politics, especially when it's presented as an easily digestible slogan slapped on a red hat. We've seen those idealized pasts pop up in the Monday morning quarterbacking that's followed this election. A number of these interpretations have put nostalgia front and center. One I'll call the hillbilly elegy hypothesis. From the coal miners to the Rust Belt, blue-collar voters heard the clarion call that their way of life would return Their economic interests would be addressed, their communities would once again thrive, and their way of life would return. Global economic policy and market forces be damned. A second, closely related to what we discussed a little bit earlier, I'll call the Christendom hypothesis. Tired of the supposed atheist slash socialist slash liberal slash secret Muslim agenda that occupied the White House for the last 8 years, evangelicals organized to reclaim it with the hope of ending Roe versus Wade, enacting so-called religious freedom acts, and welcoming God back into the White House. Or the political correctness hypothesis. As everyone, quote unquote, knows, men are men, women are women, Islam is violent, undocumented immigrants are dangerous. What should be self-evident has been disguised and repressed by a force called political correctness. Once upon a time, the notion goes, common sense was common. Making America great again is a rejection of political correctness in order that common sense may be restored, and we can all think in the right way, like we used to. Our way of life will return. God will be welcomed back. Common sense will be restored. Nostalgia brings with it the illusion of certainty, that there was once upon a time an idealized, simpler, better past that we remember. The flaws, or simply the complexities, of that past disappear in the fuzz of our memory. And if we just replicate, reconstruct, or bring back this idealized and sanitized version of the past, our desires will be satisfied. I'm reminded of an online joke that began circulating not long after Donald Trump was directly questioned about his appeal to nostalgia and asked for an example of when America was truly great. What would you guess his answer was? The 1950s. And so the joke went like this. Why do so many people romanticize the 1950s? Calm down, everyone. We still have milkshakes and we still have racism. For every happy days-like fantasy that nostalgia holds up as an ideal, there's a Jim Crow reality that nostalgia represses, disguises, or flat out lies about. In American Christianity, nostalgia makes for a particularly pernicious problem. By perpetuating idealized half-truths or outright lies as certainties for the sake of our own desires for what we long for, nostalgia functions as a type of idolatry. In fact, I would go to say as far that nostalgia functions as the idolatrous inversion of resurrection. Now, what do I mean by that? While clearly as a Christian minister, when I use the word resurrection, I am noting Christ's resurrection, the good news of the empty tomb as told in the Christian scriptures. But I tend to think of the gospel and Pauline reports of resurrection not as a historical or supernatural event confined to the life of Christ, but as an invitation to Christian practice. In Christian practice, resurrection is when life is victorious unexpectedly, when we think that death has the final word. Whether that unexpected life comes through the pastoral ministries of reconciliation, faithful witness in the streets and on Capitol steps, or in the poetry and healing work of liturgy and beauty. Nostalgia, on the other hand, is the idolatrous hope that if we keep propping up, talking up, and beating on a dead horse, it will come back to life. Resurrection is mystery and surprise. Like other forms of idolatry, like the memory of a 1950s Woolworths with a great milkshake that conveniently overlooks the segregated lunch counter where it is served, nostalgia is forced. It isn't real, and it doesn't bring forth life. But that doesn't mean it isn't seductive. The certainty of nostalgia and the facade of safety that nostalgia projects is what draws us in. We like safety, we like certainty, we like familiarity. Nostalgia shows us the apple we remember so fondly and tells us, if you eat it, you will not die. You heard that one before? Let us return to our old pastor. His hearing slipping on the last act of his life, He's beginning to confront the reality of death. He's beginning to confront the past, too, his unrealized hopes, especially in the case of civil rights, and he's mourning the violence, destruction, and loss of life that he sees all around him. As Walter Brueggemann argues in The Prophetic Imagination, our old pastor has penetrated a self-involved numbness that allows him to confront the mortality of the entire world, and is thus in the midst of lament. And lament is the root of empathy, which in turn, the root of love of neighbor, which is the root of justice. Though it is painful, the pastor rejects the apple, and he embraces an uncertain future. And that's the work of the church, right? When we practice resurrection, we participate in a mystery that moves toward justice, confronts death, and opens the door to a possibility that looks nothing like the past. But that's easier said than done. Not long ago, I preached from Ephesians, one of those letters that scholars often classify as Deuteropauline, so not written by Paul. So fake news, right? But written by a student of Paul, or written in Paul's name. The passage from the fifth chapter, though in the middle of a cataloging of practical teaching, is perhaps the most poetic section of the letter. The writer tells its readers, "For once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light. For the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord." Try to find out what is pleasing to God. The writer of this letter spends a considerable amount of time telling his or her readers that they have been transformed. They have been invited into the practice of resurrection. And then, in the midst of a list of practical instructions for living, things that you would assume would be written in a way that are crystal clear, we encounter a nod to ambiguity, a nod to discernment, and a nod to the sort of freedom to experiment as to what being the light might be. Try to find out what is pleasing to God. Now, when we read the entire letter, we not only get that nod to ambiguity, that nod to discerning, but we get a nice little hint as to how such an instruction brings its own risks. After all, just a few verses later, you get this little nugget, one that's not popular in my house. "Wives, be subject to your husbands, as you are to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is head of the church, the body of which he is the Savior. Just as the church is subject to Christ, so also wives ought to be in everything to their husbands." It's incredible how when we try to be the light, we often leave so many in the dark. In an age when we are so divided politically, theologically, in our social commitments, even in our ways of understanding what it means to be part of our religious traditions or part of the American fabric, the mistake the community that gave birth to Ephesians made, ignoring how the light we try to make becomes darkness for others, sometimes unintentionally, is the mistake that we who confuse nostalgia for a future and we who settle for brutal partisanship because we believe it helps us become who we truly are, even if it means setting boundaries sharp enough to wound or kill. When we make this mistake, what we do is turn the good news of the gospel into the fake news of a church that is one more institution that can't be trusted. But I have to admit, I'm thankful for this letter to the Ephesians. In its entirety, even with this damaging, dark little nugget, because I think there is hope in discovering that our first and second century forebears understood the ways they tried to practice resurrection, not as subscribing to calcified doctrine, but as a fluid, almost improvisational way of being community, trying to get it right. And I'm grateful to see that they screwed up too. And in a time of idolatry and nostalgia, I'm grateful to read that a first century church didn't get it right the first time or the second time, but encouraged its communities to keep on trying, even as they simultaneously messed up. It's in that light that I've been rethinking one of my most beloved pieces of my tradition, the Disciples of Christ, the open table. Both as practice in terms of the practice of the Lord's Supper and as symbol of our commitment to Christian unity. It figures prominently in my theology. And in disciples' theology, generally, I would say it names the table as a non-exclusionary divine welcome and lived out reality. We welcome all as Christ welcomes us. That invitation to all is both comfort and inspiration to me. But over the last several months, I've been considering the inadequacy of the invitation to the open table. When we tell the story of remembrance around the table, or when we tell the heroic stories of our tradition, how we've had an ecumenical commitment before it was a thing, do we find ourselves falling into the trap of nostalgia? And doesn't every church say everyone is welcome? And how many people do we know who have heard this invitation? That everyone is welcome, received it, but found out that as women who seek ordination, queer folk who want to be married, people who want to struggle against institutional racism to simply be recognized, they have found that both everyone and welcome can very often be accompanied by asterisks. Or just as often, how many people have encountered our community's deeply woven familiarity with one another, the specifics of our churchy language, or the local quirks that we turn into orthodoxies, come into our churches and wonder beyond this welcome to the table if they could ever fit in. Our light may leave others in the dark, after all. It is no longer adequate to say we welcome all to the table. In the tradition of the disciples, the table has long been a contradictory thing. We set the boundary that identifies and defines our identity by setting no boundaries at all. However, in a time when boundaries are set with tribalist, idolatrous brutality, we can no longer assume that a passive, open welcome is heard as something transformative. Christ welcomes all. But we resist everything. Even those things deep inside of us that block access to the table that God opens to all people. We do not only welcome, but we resist. The table, therefore, becomes the center of a politics of resistance. But this Christian politic of resistance cannot become another crude partisan boundary. We repeat the story of a broken body and spilled blood in order to proclaim wholeness. Brokenness and wholeness, therefore, are clearly intertwined. And a non-nostalgic look at our embodied humanity means confronting this honestly. Our differences and our conflicts must be welcomed to the table. We do this welcome at a table that God opens to all, to women and men, to refugee and undocumented, to queer and straight, to black and brown, to the whole world. Only in making that welcome explicit through the language of resistance can we truly remember a simultaneously broken and whole body made out of people who are both. Otherwise, we once again offer darkness when we try to offer light. If there is one thing about which I agree with Steve Bannon, it is that the 20th century offered global bloody conflict on a scale that we never really saw before. But this supposed Christian century, as it was called, brought with it a number of responses. A global system for the resettlement of refugees, the United Nations, other cross-national or ecumenical or interfaith attempts at peace building, a vast sustainable development anti-poverty apparatus, and movements for anti-racist and gender equality justice all over the world. And at the risk of sounding nostalgic myself, we stand at the precipice of abandoning that legacy, exchanging it for a much more brutal, isolationist world. But rather than simply fall into a nostalgic illusion, whether of a remembered first century or remembered 20th century, we need to follow the example of that writer trying to shake things up in Ephesus. The church must extract itself from the brutality, teach its people how to radically open tables with our public lives. Everything we do must be a resistant and welcoming table, so that we may try until our faith becomes a sanctuary for anyone who needs it. Welcome must be our doctrine, and resistance our sacrament. In a time when we fear that we are witnessing the long con disguised as populism undoing our democratic institutions, in a time when our nostalgia makes us complicit, that must be the shape of Christian moral leadership in the days to come. Welcome our doctrine. Resistance, our sacrament. This will push us to become open in ways that stretch us all and defiant in ways that scare the hell out of us. As I believe this openness will mean that we must listen to voices we will never expect to hear, I offer you one more voice that is not exactly my own. The atheist advises the pastor. No one else will ever see the stars you dream so often. So pencil punch through the black cardboard, lift it up, make them see when your light shines through. But do not do more than this. When you break bread, tell the tales you always tell. But if you tell the one about enough for all, make sure you give it all away. Do not dare waste a crumb. You know what to do with the wine. But should you speak of mountaintops that you long to reach but may never, of temples that risk the sky, or of a million souls rinsed clean by your hand in a river you must reach, remember just how long cardboard actually lasts, even covered in Hebrew and Greek, and put to bed each one of those earthly ambitions. Choose instead to stay behind and bury the dead. Thank you.
Thank you, Brandon, so very much. And part of our tradition at the Turner Warren Lecture, after our speaker speaks, we open up the whole floor in the whole room to some questions and to some response. We want this very interactive, as it always is. And so we invite you now, we've got about 10, 15 minutes to take some questions or just a response. Brandon will repeat the question that he received so that it can be heard by everyone. But questions, response,
accusations of heresy, whatever.
I'm just curious. During this past election, did you see evidence of resistance, since you're using that term, from the organized church?
I think that is that's the trickiest question, I think, for going forward. I think one of the things, during this last election cycle, and is it fair to add, and afterwards, have we seen signs of resistance?
Sure.
I think that is the puzzle, the moral, and I would add logistical puzzle that the church faces, is what does resistance look like? And for me, I kind of lined out, it's sacramental and theological, and it's with boots on the ground in a lot of ways. And I think one of the things that's difficult is figuring out what that is actually going to look like. I think what we've seen so far is a fairly brutal agenda followed by incompetent deal-making, you know, in the first couple of months. So it's hard to understand what resistance, you know, might look like in terms of real-life stuff. The second thing that I think is interesting is, as good, polite, mainline Protestants, we're people who have long supported the Johnson Amendment, you know, that a very kind of clear line that we are nonprofit organizations that have a very specific agenda in society, and that crossing into lobbying or kind of interference is not only, you know, kind of a no-no according to the Johnson Amendment, but also unethical. And so there's this kind of muddy water that we're trying to kind of live into. If indeed, as I would say, we're now living in kind of an era where democratic institutions have been used to undermine democracy itself. And so we have to ask the question of, what do we hold dear? So I think there's still a lot of discernment that is going on. There are a lot of people who are standing up and speaking and saying, these things are immoral. A budget, for example, needs to be a moral document, and one that leaves behind the poor and leaves behind science is not. And so I think we see these kind of very beginnings of that. But I think, you know, this last year, I know everyone that I know kind of socially wants to just pretend or wish that 2016 just didn't happen for a variety of reasons. But I think there's still this kind of, what do we do and how do we do it sort of sense. Love your neighbor as yourself, right? So the comment was, I've heard from a number of my friends, don't worry, the political situation won't impact you. And, you know, I mean, that's about as anti-Christian as it gets, right? You know, only think of yourself.
Can you give us an example of how a church like First Christian Church in Lynchburg, Virginia begins practicing resurrection? Mm-hmm. The invitation is made, but how do we begin practicing?
How does a church like First Christian Church, Lynchburg, Virginia, how does it practice resurrection? I think it's kind of a three-layered thing. I think it is a spiritual life that deeply interweaves, you know, a sense of justice in that spiritual life. That those two things are absolutely inseparable. I think that there's a very particular risk that churches have to take. And that's why I kind of use this language about the boundaries we set have to be no boundaries at all. I think that the church of the 21st century has to figure out a way to be Christian, but also to be non-exclusive in even new ways. The most exclusively sounding named church that I know is Country Club Christian Church in Kansas City, Missouri. I mean, that's a crazy name for a church, right? Country Club. But it's a fantastic church. And one of the things that I know about this church is that there is a group, and some of these are spouses of members, some of these are just kind of folks from the area who, you know, would claim themselves to be atheists, but are deeply part of that community. Not members of the church, but they show up every week, they're part of these sort of things, and they have been welcomed to that church. Not only as people who are welcomed for who they are, but they are people who have been welcomed to say, you know, I don't get this, or I think that's BS, and you are still part of that community. And I think those sort of things are the risks that we need to take, even as kind of people who see ourselves as good, open-minded progressives. We need to be able to risk the sort of openness that pushes us out of our comfort.
If you could elaborate on these terms that we get to hear today more often. The first is discrimination, legal, making it more legal. The other is how religious rights may be connected to that, right, to discriminate against someone.
Sure.
And then finally, how did we go about understanding the fear taking place on other people, even different than we are?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So there were two questions there. One, kind of going through kind of issues of discrimination and religious practice. Is that a fair way to kind of summarize that up? And then the second one is about fear.
Well, the legal aspect of making it into law.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, so are you talking about kind of those religious freedom acts? Okay. So, yeah, talking a little bit about religious freedom acts that you see kind of passed by state legislatures, and you see even discussion of it happening kind of at the national level. It's a really sort of fascinating dynamic, I would say, and it played really prominently for us as disciples just a couple of years ago when there was, in Indiana, one of those bills was signed into law, and it was amended in part because there was pushback and resistance from the disciples because our General Assembly was going to be there. And there were questions about, would everybody who attends the General Assembly be able to fully participate in Indiana commerce based on one of these? And these laws essentially say that, you know, the government cannot interfere with the religious practice of a privately held or closely held company. Something like that. And it gets interpreted, you know, kind of the rhetoric around it is, well, if you're a Christian baker, this is the example that often is used, someone who bakes cakes and you don't believe in same-sex marriage, you cannot be sued if, you know, you refuse service. And of course, these are vague enough sort of things that anybody who says, I, on religious grounds, object to this and this and this, would not be able to be sued. You know, that's the pushback there. And I think it's an interesting conflict. When I step away from, you know, how it kind of personally makes me very angry, it's a very interesting conflict because it does kind of put two things in conflict. Our ability to kind of live lives as individuals with very particular tastes, religious commitments, et cetera, and our role as citizens, where everybody puts a little bit in and everybody gets a little bit out of the country and nation in which we live. And so, you know, in many ways, it's, to me, this fear really kind of is not as much fear as it is selfishness, right? Because, you know, like, I don't want to make you a cake because I think there's something wrong about the way that you're living. Well, that's fine if you don't want to make a cake within your own little religious fiefdom. But when you're talking about a broader multicultural society, are you really, you know, reneging on your commitment to citizenship while receiving the benefits of it? And I think that is the conversation that we kind of need to have more broadly and more openly about what it means to have a law like this kind of on the books or not. And I do think fear is a terrible drug. You know, it's a strong drug. And, you know, again, like, with these sort of boundaries, these kind of weaponized boundaries that I'm kind of talking about, we want to protect everything that we are and everything that we have, and fear is kind of at the basis of that. And in kind of describing who we are in a way that is, you know, on the offensive, you know, fear plays a big role in that. Does that help? I know that was kind of a meandering answer.
I'm troubled by one thing you said, and I don't think you meant this, but I'd like you to clarify it. You talked about Steve Bannon going to the Vatican, and you talked about the statements that he made as coming from the Vatican. They did not.
No, I'm sorry, yeah.
They came from a small group within the Vatican that he was appealing to. That's my understanding.
Yeah, I'm sorry if that wasn't clear. Yeah, it was, yeah, I just meant physically within the grounds of the Vatican. Yeah, that it was a small kind of proto-nationalist Christian identity organization with close ties to a Catholic bishop. They were able to get a room in the Vatican and have that meeting. Yes, absolutely, that's correct. Yeah, so sorry if that was confusing. But yeah, but the first resistance.
Say more about what resistance is the sacrament. Right. Mean.
I think for me, it has begun with the language that we use, very specifically at the table. So, you know, what I actually say, you know, when we gather for communion is I say, you know, everyone is welcome here, and we resist any tendency in ourselves or in the wider world that blocks access to this table. And to me, that, you know, that's kind of the first step, and I'm, you know, we're trying, you know, in the couple of weeks that happened, in the first couple of weeks of January, we sent money to our local refugee resettlement service, which we as a church hadn't done for probably about 10 years. You know, and so there are things like that more concretely that we are starting to do and trying to figure out more strategically how to do it rather than just kind of case by case. But for me, it begins liturgically with the language that we use. That has to change. If we really believe that the language that we use in church is transformative, we have to be very specific and we have to be very clear with what we mean. Yes, it's great to welcome all. Nothing wrong with that. But we have to say more than just we welcome.
Encourage me that you speak of nostalgia as being a danger of idolatry. And I must admit that I kind of live in a life of nostalgia because I remember so well, and I'm a good deal older than you are, but I remember so well when a congregation, when a church like this was filled every Sunday with 250 people. Mm-hmm. I remember so well what a church like this would receive 100 or 150 new members every year. Now that seems almost like a foreign country. What happened? Because I'm not that old. that was only 40 years ago, maybe 50 years ago, when mainline churches like this one were burgeoning, so to speak. And still, we were preaching. We were inspired by Reinhold Niebuhr and by people like that, and we thought we were on top of the world. Suddenly all this has come. What's happened to it? Tell me that.
Yeah, what's happened to it? There's a great little book that came out last year called The End of White Christian America, which I highly recommend anyone picking that up. And it crunches the numbers and it narrativizes the numbers, and it basically kind of looks at what has happened to the mainline and evangelical church, because. You know, despite the PR, the fact is the evangelical church is in decline as well. You know, you look at the numbers for the Southern Baptists, you know, the mainline numbers may look like this. Southern Baptist numbers are only up a little bit higher and not quite as steep, but it's a similar decline. It's funny, this book begins with three quick little quips, and it tells the story of the Methodist women's building by the Supreme Court. You guys know about this building? So there's a building that the Methodist women own right next to the Supreme Court that was purchased at the beginning of the 20th century around the issue of prohibition. Okay, so that women who were fighting demon rum, you know, would have a moral voice in Washington. Okay, and this, you know, this building is there. It's very expensive real estate. There are a couple of Methodist folks who work in that. There are also a number of small NGOs, faith-based and otherwise, that also work there. And then they told the story of the Inner Church Center in Manhattan, okay, which was, again, was built at this time that you're kind of talking about. Like, you know, churches, the mainline churches on the top of the world. It's going to be something, you know, transformative in this very corporate, secular way. Yeah. So yeah. I've had meetings at the women's office, and I've had meetings there. There on Riverside Drive. Yeah, and the National Council of Churches, which kind of helped build that building, they don't even have their offices there anymore. You've had this sort of shift. And the third building that they tell a little quip about is the Crystal Cathedral, which again was this huge monument to evangelical Christianity, which went into bankruptcy and was sold to a Catholic diocese. Mainly Hispanic worshipers worship in the Catholic church that is now the Crystal Cathedral. So it uses those three stories as kind of parables to talk about this sort of change. And the way that I read all of these statistics and the shift is I'll say kind of two things. Number one, the cultural expectation around Christianity, mainline, evangelical, or otherwise, has shifted in this country, which I think is a good thing. Okay, Okay? I mean, it used to be that church was not only the place that you went to get your spiritual needs met, and please hear that very consumerist language that I'm using, you know, to describe that. But it was also the place where you went to make connections for your job. That's disappeared. And I think that that is a good thing for the integrity of who we are as the church. We're not church, country club, social club, networking spot anymore. We're the place where we articulate the gospel. I think that that's a very good thing. The second thing, I think that there's a subtle, often classism in the mainline church that we haven't always addressed. In fact, I think the term mainline comes from, I believe it's a train line in Philadelphia, right? Among, you know, this kind of suburban, very upper middle class sort of rail. And you would see first whatever church, along the main line. Well, what does that have to do with being in solidarity with the marginalized? Not a damn thing. So, I mean, I think that there's something kind of that we have to address and kind of, you know, break down about who it is that we have been. Niebuhr is important, but so is living out Niebuhr.
Brandon?
Yes.
I need you to help me put this question together. I think you describe yourself as a Gen Xer,
mm-hmm.
I think. And you also describe me as a Facebook solver. And that's true. And I love hanging out with Gen Xers, millennials, the younger folk, and I see lots of passion on Facebook comments or in conversation with younger folk who. Are there any other Gen Xers or millennials here?
Good point.
But my question is, you know, how can we help, how can us more mature folk get this dialogue going with folks with such passion and energy and us all get in the conversation?
Sure.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
How
I mean, it's
can we best and take that passion that I'm seeing? I'm not sure what to do with it. I'm not sure I do either.
Well, I think the question is, you know, when you have generations that see everything from how we analyze the world to how we are citizens of it very differently, and often the way that we communicate that is mediated by very different languages. You know, social media is a different language, you know, in a lot of ways. How do we hear each other? I'm 41 now, and you know, when I was younger, I used to, you know, have the credibility to talk about being a young adult in ministry. I no longer have that credibility. But the disciples of a young adult, yeah. But I used to say that if you as an Xer or a millennial walked into church, you had two questions. Like the first question is, you know, will you welcome me? You know. Full stop, as I am, and will you listen to me? And I think that's the big thing. And I think it's really important to realize that when, you know, the folks that we identify as millennials, the church often infantilizes them. But the fact is, they're 22, they're 26, they're 30, they're 35, and they are treated as adults in their professions. And are, you know, I mean, you know. The folks who are, you know, the folks who are kind of looked at as the new entrepreneurs. I mean, in Chattanooga, we have an innovation district because we have this public utility high-speed internet service, and so we're bringing in folks who were, you know, who've heard about the low cost of living, who were setting up startups in Silicon Valley. They're coming, you know, to Chattanooga. You know, Lisa and I have gone to meetings in the innovation district, and you know, we're the old folks there. Okay. And so, you know, I think it's really, really important to understand that, yes, there's kind of wisdom that can be transferred across generations, but there has to be a more equal playing field where, you know, it's not just, listen, young child, you need to learn, you know, you need to learn the wisdom of the church before you do A, B, and C, but what can we truly learn as partners from one another?
The resistance, our sacrament, that's grabbed me, and so how do we resist together, I guess?
Yeah, that's right. I think that's the thing. And that in community organizing, there's a lot of talk about, you know, how you articulate what your self-interest is. in order to come to, you know, kind of a, an understanding of what our shared self-interest is. And so, you know, as pastors start to think about how to expand their skill set, that kind of community organizing model is going to be more and more important, I think, for doing that.
One more question. One more lucky person.
If there's no more questions, I'm the lucky person.